In this video, I want to show two more examples of how a typical induction proof looks like. When it comes to an induction proof, there's always three parts. You have a base case, where you're going to prove that the statement is true for basically the smallest natural number that's appropriate. Then you're going to do the inductive hypothesis, which is just a statement of an assumption. You're going to assume it's true for an arbitrary case. And then you'll have the inductive application, for which then you'll prove that the next number also has the property because of the inductive hypothesis. And those three ingredients together give us a typical induction proof. So with this one right here, let's do a divisibility type argument. Maybe you do something like this in number theory. Prove that every integer of the form 10 to the n plus 1 power plus 3 times 10 to the nth power plus 5 is always divisible by 9 for any natural number n. And so the proof right here, it's usually good when you do it, when you start a proof by induction, to say that what you're going to do, right? So we'll say something like, we proceed by induction. Now, when you're watching these videos, I want to make you aware that when I write these proofs in real time, this isn't the best polished proof. You might want to go to the lecture notes, which are linked to this video, to actually see a better looking version of the proof. The reason I'm doing this in real time, as opposed to just reading a proof here, is that this is meant to be instructional. As a professor, I'm trying to teach you how to write proofs, right? And so I want to write it in real time, so you kind of think, so you know what I think about when I would write in a proof here. Different styles, different structures of the proof. Although this is not necessarily a final draft of a proof, I'm trying to show you the structure of how one does these type of proofs. So you should start off by telling people what you're going to do, right? We're going to proceed by induction. You don't want to just kind of just randomly walk through a proof and leave the audience unaware of what's going on here. It's like, what? You should tell them, we proceed by induction, or something equivalent to that. And if you want to actually enumerate the parts, you can do that. I don't necessarily do that myself when I write the proof. But as your professor here, I am going to indicate exactly what we're doing here. So the base case. So we want to consider what's the smallest natural number for which this property is going to be true. And although n equals 1 makes sense, it turns out we can be a little bit better. N equals 0. When you're proving stuff by induction, it's always a good idea to think about, would n equals 0 make sense? And if it does make sense, I would actually include that as the base case. So let n equals 0. And so then consider, in that situation, your number, right? You have 10 to the n plus 1 plus 3 times 10 to the n plus 5. That would look like 10 to the first plus 3 times 10 to the 0 plus 5. 10 to the first will, of course, be 10. 10 to the 0 is a 1, so you're going to get a 3 plus 5. This adds up to be 18. 18 is 2 times 9. And so, therefore, it holds for the base case. All right, so we then, that's kind of like our base case. We finished it, so now we move on. Great. So then we go to our inductive hypothesis, in which case we're going to assume that 9 divides the number 10 to the k plus 1 plus 3 times 10 to the k plus 5 for some number k, which is greater than or equal to 0, right? That's one way you could phrase it, or in other words, you could say it like, so there exists some integer, what do I want to call it? Let's call it, say, m. There exists some integer m such that 10 to the k plus 1 plus 3 times 10 to the n, 10 to the k, excuse me, be consistent on your variable there, plus 5 equals 9m. That's what we'll do. So we'll actually have the multiple specific here. Now to the inductive case, right? So now using the inductive hypothesis, we want to consider when we take n to be k plus 1. So now consider the case when n equals k plus 1. So we're going to take this number. We're going to take 10 to the k plus 2 plus 3 times 10 to the k plus 1. Plus 5. We want to show that 9 divides this number in some way or another, okay? And so this is why proof writing is a creative process, because the next step might not be obvious why we take it. As one explores these problems, it does kind of seem natural to do it here. It's like, okay, what's the next step? Well, I have to somehow find the number 10k plus 1 plus 3 times k and plus a 5, right? And I kind of have that here, but I have an extra 10. Maybe we should factor out that 10. So for example, if you factor out the 10 from the first two numbers there, you're going to get 10 times 10 k plus 1 plus 3 times 10 to the k, like so. And then you have the plus 5 still. So it's kind of what you have there. It's like, well, you know, I almost have what I need, except I need a plus 5 right here. So what if I just add a plus 5, you know, no one's looking, you sneak it in there. Well, we want it to be true, right? We need equality here. And so if we add a 5, we should just subtract a 5. But we really didn't add 5, we took 10 times 5, right? So this 10 would distribute onto each of these terms right here, right? So this is kind of like when we complete the square. So we're going to actually subtract 5 times 10 to balance out the 5 we added there. The reason why this is useful is that this number right here is then by our inductive hypothesis going to equal 9m. And so this is how we're using the inductive hypothesis. We use it right here. So continuing on there, we're going to get 10 times 9m plus 5 minus 50, like so. Simplifying this, we get 9 times 10m minus 45. Oh, looky there, 45 is a multiple of 9, isn't it? It is 9 times 5. So we get 9 times 5. If you factor out the 9, you're going to get 9 times 10m minus 5. And therefore, we see that 9 divides the number in question here. And so this is exactly what we were trying to show. And so that then proves the inductive case. And so then we conclude with something like, therefore, the result follows by induction. And that is how our induction proof will work. We had our base case, our induction hypothesis, and our inductive case. That's how it finishes. Let's look at one more example of this. This time, we're actually going to prove an inequality using induction. Again, this is going to be a little bit more tricky than an equation, but the principles of induction are going to work the same way here. As we try to prove it, this is going to be a proof by induction, so we proceed. We proceed by induction. And so we're going to first consider the situation. What's the right natural number to start here? Oftentimes they should tell you. I'm going to start with n equals 0 because n equals 0, the statement's true. So notice when n equals 0 here, you're going to get that 2 to the 0 is equal to 1, which is greater than 0, like so. Great. And so this proves the base case. So we have some base case. I usually like to start with the base case. So then next, we'll make our induction hypothesis. Assume that 2 to the k is greater than just k for some k greater than or equal to 0. So this is our inductive hypothesis. Now, consider the case where n equals k plus 1. So you're going to have some inequalities here, right? You're going to have 2 to the k plus 1. We have to somehow relate this to our inductive hypothesis. So I'm going to probably do that by factoring, right? 2 to the k plus 1 is 2 times 2 to the k, which then by our inductive hypothesis, we know that 2 to the k is greater than k. So this will be 2 times k right here. And again, it's a good idea to be explicit here. Our inductive hypothesis was used on this inequality right here. And so now, well, how do we connect this to what we're looking for? 2k right here. 2k, this is equal to k plus k, like so. And k is actually going to be greater than or equal to 1, k plus 1 here. Since we already took care of the base case, we could actually, which is 0, we can actually say that k is strictly greater than 0, right? I have to be like a little bit careful here. We want k plus k to be greater or equal to 1. So the thing is, this is where it gets a little bit fishy, right? It turns out that the argument doesn't quite work when k equals 0. We actually need that this thing is greater than or equal to 1 to make the following argument work. So that if k is greater or equal to 1, then this k is greater or equal to 1. And then we get the statement we want right there. And so in this situation, you might actually be justified in doing a second base case. Sometimes you need to do that. Let's do n equals 0 or n equals 1. If you take n equals 1, that's equal to 2, which is greater than 1. It's not a big deal. If you have to do an extra base case or two, that's perfectly fine. Do as many as necessary so we get this thing to work, right? It's true for 0, but for this argument to follow, it kind of needs to be greater than or equal to 1. So we make that statement right there, and then we're done. Therefore, the result follows by induction. And so this gives us two more examples of a typical induction argument. And in the homework, you'll have plenty of opportunity to practice this principle some more.